Good morning, church. It's Sunday again, and another chance to be present to this life and to each other. This week, I spent some very grounding time getting things cleaned up in my garden, which requires a particular kind of attention, looking at plants not as types or categories, but as individuals with their own particular quirks and shapes. We have lots of cucumbers this year. I don't know why. We've never been successful with cucumbers before, but I'm eating them right off the vine and they are delicious. And we have lots of green tomatoes right now, which I am hoping if things warm up a little bit, will eventually ripen into beautiful salads and sauces. And one of the things I notice about the garden is you can't just wait for it to become something else. And you can't lean backwards, wishing it were like it used to be. You have to notice and attend to things in their particularities exactly as they are. That's kind of the theme for today's service. We're in this series about who we are becoming as a church. And this morning, Julie Greer joins me in a conversation about becoming able to recognize and attend to our bodies as they are now, instead of waiting for things to be different or missing how they used to be. So in the spirit of that conversation, I invite you to be a little bit more present in your own body right in this very moment. Maybe roll your shoulders up and back and down or around. Maybe roll your head a little bit. Feel your neck muscles loosen a little. Maybe even stretch your fingers out. Maybe wiggle your toes. Be present in your actual body for this service. What if God could meet you right here, exactly as you are? What if God looked at this body right now, exactly as you are, and said, perfect? What would that feel like? If you haven't already, I invite you to light your first church candle. Here's mine already lit, or another candle that you have if you'd rather, recognizing the presence of the Holy Spirit in the space between us, the very distance, the very time, keeping us connected. And I invite you to make a little space in your body and in your heart for the peace of Christ to enter in. May Christ's peace be in your every breath, infusing your every moment. And let me make sure you know how very welcome you are to be in this service. You are welcome if you feel alive to your body and joyful in your movement, or if you feel trapped in your body and totally stuck, or if you feel entirely distant from your body, or a little bit of each. You are welcome if you are loving this cool summer we're having in Berkeley, or longing for warmth, or a little bit of each. Welcome if you're young or old, or a little bit of each, queer or straight, or a little bit of each, male or female, or both, or neither, transgender or cisgender, or non-binary, or somewhere else in God's beautiful universe of genders. Welcome to couch potatoes and athletes, gourmet chefs and lovers of TV dinners, extroverts and introverts. Welcome if you're housed or unhoused, employed or unemployed, or retired or studying, documented or undocumented, disabled or able-bodied, in the pink of health or at death's door. You make this particular body of Christ whole and perfect because you are here, and I am so grateful for you. Welcome, of course, if you're live with me on Sunday at 10:30, and welcome if you're worshiping later too. Please go ahead and share the service on social media if you get a moment for that, if you're on there, so people who are looking for church can find us. Please do fill out the welcome form at fccb.org/welcome so we can keep up with what's going on in your life. And if you can, if you're on a device where it's accessible to you, I encourage you to get in the comments, say good morning to each other, and move beyond the basic greeting by sharing a little something. This morning, the prompt for that sharing is to share one part of your body that you love. I will start by sharing that I love my strong stature and my height. I can reach high things and lift heavy stuff And that makes me feel really happy, even though sometimes I feel like I take up a lot of space and society wishes for waifish folks. In my best moments, I love and appreciate what my body is capable of. And as you share the thing about your body that you love, one small thing, let's sing our opening hymn together, which is Come My People. Let's sing.
Come to worship, love is in the warmth of this place. Sing to God a song of thanksgiving, sing to God a song of praise. Gather in safety, welcomed in Christian love. God touches us with strength from above. Welcome to worship, love is in the warmth of this place. Sing to God a song of thanksgiving, sing to God a song of praise. Stories of Jesus show us the way to live, how to serve others, how to forgive. Sing to God a song of thanksgiving, sing to God a song of praise. Stand with each other in one community, working together, God's reign to see. Come my people, welcome to worship, love is in the warmth of this place. Sing to God a song of thanksgiving, sing to God a song of praise.
O Lord, you have searched me and known me. You know when I sit down and when I rise up. You discern my thoughts from far away. You search out my path and my lying down and are acquainted with all my ways. Even before a word is on my tongue, O Lord, you know it completely. You hem me in behind and before and lay your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It is so high that I cannot obtain it. Where can I go from your spirit? Or where can I flee from your presence? If I ascend to heaven, you are there. If I make my bed in Sheol, you are there. If I take the wings of the morning and settle at the farthest limits of the sea, even there your hand shall lead me, and your right hand shall hold me fast. If I say, surely the darkness shall cover me, and the light around me become night. Even the darkness is not dark to you, the night is as bright as a day, for darkness is as light to you. For it was you who formed my inward parts. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Wonderful are your works
that I know very well.
My frame was not hidden from you when I was being made in secret, intricately woven in the depths of the earth.
Your eyes beheld my unformed substance.
In your book were written all the days that were formed for me,
when none of them yet existed.
How weighty to me are your thoughts, O Lord! How vast is the sum of them! I try to count them, there are more than the sand. I come to the end. I am still with you.
Hi, I'm Jean. This is the part of our service that's especially for the children. Today's scripture reading is a psalm, which is a part of the Bible that's written like poetry or songs. So I thought I'd start with a little song. While I'm singing, please pay attention to what I'm doing with my hands and arms. I am lovable and capable. I am lovable and capable. I am lovable and capable. I-A-L-A-C. You might have noticed that while I was singing the words with my voice, I was also signing in American Sign Language, ASL, a language used by the deaf community in our country. This is the sign for me or I. This is a sign for myself. This is a sign for love or lovable. And capable. Capable means that you're able to do things. You can do it. This is a strong sign. I can do it. This is also the sign for can or able. And then at the end, I was fingerspelling the first letter of each word in that phrase. I-A-L-A-C, which stands for I am lovable and capable. Lovable and capable. God made all of us lovable and capable. But I wonder if sometimes you might not feel that way. Like, maybe one day you're in a really grumpy mood, and your parent asks you to do something, and instead of doing it, you go, "No! I don't wanna! I don't have to!" And you might even stamp your feet. You're not acting very lovable right then, are you? Guess what? They still love you, and so does God. Or maybe your friend or your sibling take something of yours without even asking, and then they damage it or break it, and they don't even apologize right away. I bet you think they're not very lovable right then. You know what? We're supposed to still love them, even if we don't like them very much right now. Then there's that word capable, able to do things. As you're growing up, you're able to do more things each year, sometimes even each month or each week. Like, maybe now you can read harder books, longer books with hard words that you couldn't read last year. Or maybe you know how to make your own lunch all by yourself. Or maybe you can swim all the way across the pool without even stopping. But then there's times when you don't feel all that capable. You don't feel able to do the things that you're supposed to be doing. Like maybe you have a super hard homework assignment and this one problem, it's taking you forever. And you're just like, I can't do it. It's too hard. Don't make me do this. Or another time you might be out on a walk or a hike with your family. And there's a really steep hill that seems to go on, and you're walking and walking and getting more and more tired, and you go, I can't go any farther. Or maybe it's the other way around, and you're able to do things that the people around you can't, and you have to wait for other people to catch up. Or maybe you even have to change your activity completely just so that they can do it with you. Is that ever maybe a little disappointing or frustrating? I know I'm somebody who was always really busy. I was always out and about doing a whole bunch of different things each day. And if I were at like a store or some place with an aisle that's really narrow, or even maybe, you know, just walking down a path or sidewalk that was really narrow and only one person at a time could be walking there, if I were behind somebody who was going really slowly, and I had to stuff to do and places to be, I would just get really frustrated, and I'd be walking slowly and just looking for the first opportunity to go around them and go fast the way I wanted to go. Until something happened. This has happened a while ago now, but I was on a hike, climbing a mountain actually, and I took a little jump from one boulder to another, and something in my knee went snap. I couldn't walk anymore. They had to carry me back to the trailhead. Over the next year and a half, I had 3 surgeries on my knee. I had a brace on my leg. I had to use crutches and a cane at different times. I had to ask friends for help because I wasn't allowed to drive some of the time. And so I had to lean on people when I wasn't used to doing that. But that experience opened my eyes and helped me to become more compassionate and understanding of people around me who had different abilities than I did. I didn't get so upset anymore if somebody was doing something slowly or in a way that didn't seem like the best way of doing it. I understood that they were their own unique self and were doing things the best way that they know how. In our scripture today, this person who wrote the psalm says to God, "I praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made." Now, they didn't mean fearfully like something to be afraid of. They meant fearfully like something that brings respect and awe. You're awesome. I praise you, God, because you made me awesome. God made every one of us awesome. Whatever our abilities, whatever we can do in the way that most people do it, or whether we do things in our own unique ways based on our own abilities and needs. We are all awesome. We are all lovable and capable. In the way of a closing prayer, I have a little song to sing, another song. And this time, I'm going to use my hands and arms to play the guitar. How could anyone ever tell you you were anything less than beautiful? How could anyone ever tell you you were less than whole? How could anyone fail to notice that your loving is a miracle? How deeply you're connected to my soul. Amen.
Everybody in the church knows that I was in a car accident 5.5 long years ago.
In case you're new.
Yeah, in case you're new. And then I've undergone, over the years, I've probably had, I don't know, 7 or 8 surgeries, and different parts, but mainly my foot. And throughout these years, I've just had different levels of ability and less ability, depending on what's happening with my body in any given moment. And it's just, it's been an interesting journey for me to come to the place of accepting that my body is not going to be what it was prior to the accident.
Yeah.
And what that means for me and my family.
Yeah.
And our future. You know, I joke that, like, I have these rose-colored glasses on, and I'd be almost to the finish line, and then somebody would come along and slap the rose-colored glasses off my face with reality. And so, you know, that's happened a few times, I'm at a point of, you know, it's taken 5.5 years, which is a little embarrassing, but I'm at a point of setting the rose-colored glasses down and kind of addressing who I am today and, you know, how am I going to live my best life today with the body that I have today.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I've gotten a lot of comfort over the years in misplaced comfort in doctors saying, well, we just have to do X. Mm-hmm. And once we do X,
yeah,
you'll be back to normal or whatever yeah. normal is, right? And X has happened again, and I'm still not there. And so now it's going to yeah. be like down the rabbit hole of searching for
yeah.
the next thing that is going to improve functioning. Yeah. So,
in a way, it's sort of postponing grief to say, like, you don't have to reckon with this because don't grieve it because you don't know yet.
Yeah, exactly. You
know? Like, don't come to terms with the fact that this has been a probably permanently life-changing experience. Don't come to terms with that yet because you might not have to.
Right.
So push that, you know, kick that can down the road. Like, wait, don't deal with that yet because you might not have to. Instead of saying in the beginning, like, maybe do some reckoning with, like, this was a really profound experience. And even if you were to have regained function all the way back to baseline, it would still have been a profound life-altering experience.
Yes. It's really interesting because that makes me think about the fact that, so during the actual accident,
mm-hmm.
when the car pulled out in front of me and time slowed dramatically in this very strange way,
mm-hmm.
the thoughts that went through my head in that moment were, you know, oh, that car's pulling out. There is absolutely no way that I can stop. In fact, there's no way I can even get my foot on the brake in time.
Mm-hmm.
I actually had time to do kind of a moral analysis of, but I should try to put my foot on the brake because mm. it's the right thing to do for mm. this person in this other car who's mm-hmm. pulled out in front of me. So I actually contemplated that in this weird time warp that mm-hmm. is imminent accident. Did put my foot on the brake for what it's worth. And in those moments, what also went through my mind was, if I survive this, it is going to absolutely profoundly change my life mm. and my children's lives.
Mm-hmm.
I thought about that, all of that in, yeah. that, in those milliseconds. And yet, post-accident, all of the doctors have been like, we're going to get you your life back. Not in those words, but yeah. that's been the implication. And my striving has all been to get my life mm-hmm. back the way it was.
Mm-hmm.
And now I look back over these 5.5 years and I think, how different might it have been
mm.
if I had said, I don't need that life back. Yeah. I have my life now.
Yeah.
I still struggle with the temptation of falling into that
yeah.
mindset again. And, you know, and very well-meaning and loving people in my life say things like, when are you getting back to
mm-hmm.
that place?
Mm-hmm.
So it's so much in our culture.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. And it goes to we talked a little bit before we were recording, we talked a little bit about inspiration. And I think sometimes that kind of striving and that kind of saying, like, well, I refuse to accept anything other than getting my exactly former abilities back or whatever. But sometimes you get that kind of feedback, like, oh, that's so inspiring. That's so wonderful. You're yeah. so brave or whatever. When really I think there's real courage in taking a clear-eyed look without the rose-colored glasses at your life at the moment.
Mm-hmm.
Like, that's inspiring to me. That's brave to say, oh, I see things as they are.
Right.
I'm going to recognize that this is what I have, mm-hmm. that this is where I'm at right now. And I'm going to work with this.
Yeah. And that I can work with this. Yeah. And that this has value. This has meaning. You know, this has joy.
Yeah.
I can yeah. find joy in this space.
Totally.
If I let myself, if I get out of kind of waiting mode or pause or life on hold mode
mm-hmm.
and just let myself live. There's joy to be found here.
Yeah, joy and encounter and connection and meaning and, you know, meaningful action towards change and progress. Like, all that stuff is still accessible, even if it's not precisely what it used to look like. But
right.
If we get too busy looking at what things used to look like, it's easy to miss what's actually going on now, you know?
Yeah.
It makes me think about the scripture. And Julie picked out the scripture for this week. Especially the idea of being fearfully and wonderfully made, because I think we were talking before about that's kind of the reminder that we can think about that as only applying to some former self or only applying to some future self. Well, you know, God created me to be like something I'm going to be like in the future, but I'm not there yet. But that actually what the scripture says is that I am
fearfully and wonderfully made. And that is why every time that scripture is read in church since my accident, it's made me tear up.
Mm-hmm.
Because it has been a very clear reminder that who I am today in this moment, whatever condition my body is in or my mind is in or my spirit is in, I am.
But right now, this particular self, this exact body, that's a profound claim, and it pushes back against a big picture societal thing about what an ideal body is like, what God could have intended.
Right.
You know, because we really inherit this from our culture. Our culture that does a lot, we were talking about statistics and the idea of a normal or a normative body, and everybody that has any difference is sort of deviating from that norm. Like, well, God could have only intended a perfect body, a perfectly able-bodied, perfectly capable, athletic, and slender, and white, and beautiful,
and
young, and yeah, all of the things, and everything else from that is a deviation.
Right, when the fact is, nobody gets out of this life without having some time when the body is not functioning at its optimal level, however you want to look at that. Yeah.
Yeah, and it's part of the diversity of human experience.
Yeah. Yeah, every human.
Yeah.
And the idea that we have created this, we have created a built world around us that is only meant to accommodate that actually relatively brief period of time in every human's life,
mm-hmm.
when your body is working at its optimal level.
Right.
Right?
Right. Yeah, if you're lucky, you get a brief period.
If you're lucky, some people
don't even get a brief period.
Right. Right. Exactly.
Yeah. Yeah, but we have this built environment that is built around accommodating a normative body,
mm-hmm.
and not accommodating any deviation.
All
everybody
all
else.
Everybody else.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. And we give ourselves a lot of praise and credit for not needing or using tools that help with places where the built environment or where our lives are not working perfectly, you know?
Exactly.
And I think, I'm sure you've heard this from people, and I know lots of other people with disabilities hear this from people, like, oh, it's so great that you're only using a cane instead of a walker, great job, you know, or wow, it's so great to see you on your feet instead of in your wheelchair, or that we have this idea that people should sort of do with as little as possible in that way.
Right, and the intent of those comments is very loving, because it's like, I'm glad to see you're improving. I'm glad to see that your body is functioning in this more normative way. There's no, like, it's a very loving intent behind that,
mm-hmm.
but it also is, there's a push to not use those very important and helpful tools that let people with non-normative bodies move through the world. Like I was telling you that that I am now in the mode of shopping for a mobility scooter,
mm-hmm.
which I had resisted for all these years, because I kept thinking, well, you know, I'm going to be better in just a few months or a few weeks. And also this idea that it felt like giving up, which mm-hmm. is a ridiculous notion when I say it out loud, but is what I was feeling.
It's
like,
relatable. Yeah.
Am I giving up if I get a mobility scooter? And yet, you know, I was having this conversation with Lorenzo, which really was powerful. I casually said, I'm looking for a mobility scooter and I hate finally doing this, but I've been living in this very walkable neighborhood for 10 years. And for 5.5 of those 10 years, I haven't been able to walk around in it. I haven't been able to walk to the grocery store or walk to a restaurant with the kids mm-hmm. because of what's happened. And yet I've been living here for 10 years. And Lorenzo looked at me and said, well, the operative word is living, right? Mm-hmm. And it hit me like a ton of bricks. I mean, you talk about a God wink. This was like mm-hmm. a God sledgehammer to the head, right? It was like,
a loving one.
It was like, yes, I don't have to wait to live. I get to live who I am now, with the body I have now, mm-hmm. and why not use the tools available to me to let me live my life?
Yeah, and when you think about it, it's so strange, the things that we're excited about not needing and the tools that we don't feel that way about. Like, we don't praise each other, like, oh, I'm so proud of you for driving here without your glasses that you normally wear. Like, you did without that tool. No, don't do that.
Put your glasses on.
If you need the tool, use the tool.
If you need the tool, use the tool. Right.
You know, or we don't say, wow, I'm so inspired by the way that you ripped your vegetables apart by hand instead of using a knife. Like, we have tools.
We use tools.
Tools that work really well for things where everybody, you know, and it's funny how, like, tools that everybody uses are tools that we sort of consider just part of normal living,
right.
And then tools that we don't. But when it comes down to it, many people who are fortunate enough to live to an age where their mobility starts to be a little more challenging end up needing to use some tools, like a cane or a walker mm-hmm. or a wheelchair
or a scooter. Or a human friend to help.
Yep, exactly. Caregivers of various kinds. And we resist that. We resist it. Like, oh, I don't want to give in. I don't want to accept. I don't want to have to deal with the fact that things are changing, that I don't live in the body I used to live in.
Right. And now that I've come to terms with that, and I think, wow, for all of these years, I could have actually been tooling around the neighborhood with the kids, you know, instead of not being able to, if I had just come to terms with the fact that, it just seems so obvious now and so clear. And yet
hindsight, right?
When I was in it, I was just so resistant to that.
Yep. Could have been scooting over to restaurants all this time.
I know, right?
You know, and who knows? The future is not known to any of us. And who knows what your body or mine will do next?
Mm-hmm.
And even if there's a time in 6 months or a year that you find yourself not needing to use the scooter, that doesn't mean that this self doesn't get to go to a restaurant on a scooter.
Right?
It doesn't mean that this self doesn't get to go places, even if there were some future self that doesn't need it.
Yeah.
You know, that's okay. This body deserves to go to the restaurant on the scooter with your kids, you know?
Wow. Yeah. Yes.
Yeah. And if you're saying, oh, I used to be able to ride my bike up and down the hills and I was an avid cyclist and now my body isn't able to do it anymore and I'm so sad and frustrated about that. Like, there's grief.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. And there's tools.
Right.
And you need both, you know,
right.
There's grief and there's tools. There's recognizing, like, I miss that. I miss being able to power myself up to those hills and how everything felt working together and how strong I felt. And there are e-bikes.
So, yeah, and that's one of the things that really helped me kind of make this leap in my head was Lorenzo and I always take the kids camping every year.
Yeah.
And every year we set up camp. They do most of the setting up and they go out hiking and I sit in the camp in a camp chair and read a book.
Yeah.
And it's lovely, but I miss out on that.
Mm-hmm.
And I used to love to hike. And this summer we went to Yosemite,
mm-hmm.
and the kids took their bikes and I just decided I'm not going to miss out anymore. And I rented an e-bike.
Mm-hmm.
I rented an e-bike to take with us and it does all the work. And it was amazing. And I get on this bike and we're all in a row and we're tooling across the Yosemite Valley. And I had to fight not to burst into tears,
mm-hmm.
because of the sense of freedom I felt and the sense of just liberty. And of course, you know, Yosemite is so gorgeous and awesome. And I was with my kids and I was experiencing it with them.
Yeah.
And it was astounding. And that really is what kind of pushed me over the edge of like, okay, I can do this all the time. If I get the darn scooter, yeah. I can be with my kids,
mm-hmm.
and we can do things outside and
yeah.
we can go to museums and amusement parks and all of the things that I always love
yeah.
doing with my kids that I haven't done. I mean, it's like, I could do that.
Yeah. Well, you've been waiting to get, you know, to have a body that could do them the way that you used to do them. All the while missing out on the way that your body could do them now.
Yeah.
You know, and there's still grief and it might not be everything and it might not be everything the same way. And that's okay. But I think there's something to be said for accepting like this body deserves to do those things. This body gets to.
Yeah.
We this have body tools gets to. For this.
Yeah.
Yeah. And what would it be like for all of us to say, all the things that I love, this body deserves them.
Yeah.
Like, this body gets to.
Yeah.
What would the tools be like, mm-hmm. to do those things, to go those places, to not wait for some future self who is healthier or thinner or, you know, anything like that.
Less gray.
Less gray, you know, even less busy. Like,
yeah.
What would it
oh,
be like
yeah.
to say, this is the only body, this is the only moment.
This is the only time.
This
yeah.
is the time there is.
Yeah.
And let's make the connections that we can and let's find the joys that we can and let's be in our lives now.
Friends, if your heart was cracked open like mine was by Julie's wise and generous sharing, then let's seize the opportunity, the opening of our hearts a little bit, and offer what's inside them to God and to each other in prayer. I invite you to take a deep breath. As always, you can share your prayers in the comments on whatever platform you're on. You can speak them aloud. You can just hold them in your heart. God will hear. We pray this morning for all those in our community whose bodies are experiencing pain or illness right now. We pray for Emma's partner, Shay, for Michelle, for Carmel, for Kathy. We pray for Ruth, Alexandra, LaTanya, Terry, Ernest, Jessica, and Charlie. We pray for Jim McVeigh and all of our beloveds whose bodies and minds aren't as robust and stable as they used to be. We pray for our beloveds living in assisted living and nursing homes, some of whom are facing new restrictions as COVID cases increase. We pray for those in our community burdened by grief, including Elizabeth Driver Buchholz and Chris and Amelia. And we pray in gratitude for every time we meet God in the challenges of these particular bodies. for meal trains and chats and check-ins, for a ride home from surgery or a drop-off of flowers, for every time we find community when we stumble, for every time community finds us when we are lost. We thank God for those moments, and we ask God to help us recognize them. Let us pray this morning for all those burdened under the weight of the ongoing COVID-19 pandemic, for those healthcare workers in our community who are dealing with increased cases again or breakthrough cases, for teachers and families, parents and kids, for those who are sick right now, God, we pray, grant good care and ease. For those at risk, for kids whose turn hasn't come yet for vaccination, for those in parts of the world where vaccination still sounds like a pipe dream, for all of us wondering what will come next, yearning for a return to a normal life we are not sure will ever come back to us. God, we ask you, grant us courage. Teach us to trust you. Help us to recognize the gifts we have in this moment. And let us pray this morning for our beautiful earth, for all the people and places suffering under climate change, for floods and droughts, fires and frosts, famines and pandemics. God, bless us with courage to face things as they are, leaning not back into nostalgia or forward into a kind of waiting paralysis. Bless us with courage to act in the only moment we have to act in, the current moment. And bless us with collective wisdom and leadership. For all the prayers that are on our heart, God, we thank you for giving us to each other and for giving us this moment to place them in your hands. Let's join all our hearts together this morning as one, as we pray in one voice the words we learned from Jesus, the words of the Lord's Prayer. Our Creator, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Hello again. I'm Mary Hake, a longtime member of FCCB. This month, it's been my great pleasure to invite your support for A Home Within, a nationwide program that recruits and supports therapists who commit to see one current or former foster youth for free as long as it takes. A few weeks ago at Lawn Church, I was inspired by several of you sharing experiences being foster parents. This is the most generous and courageous gift there can be for these hurting children. Today, we have one more story to share of a grandmother stepping up to care for her granddaughter and the difference that being connected to a therapist through A Home Within can make.
Sarah was extremely needy, extremely clingy. What was so sad is we had started her in transitional kindergarten, and every woman that came in, her first question, always was, "Did you know my mom?" But from the time she was born, it's been mom in and out of her life, and she lived in a state of confusion. She just kind of kept to herself, and she cried all the time in school. They were always sending her down to the school counselor.
Thank you.
Dr. Abby. She's given her her childhood. She's given her friends, how to make friends, how to just be a happy kid. And that's so, to me, that's so important, because now she won't withdraw when she's older or have any kind of trust issues. She had abandonment issues, and I'm not gonna say they're gone, but I think she's more comfortable in her own skin. I think she's happy where she's at. She has her own room. She's got a sense of belonging, and she's got stability. She's enjoying school. She's got friends in school. I was never so happy as when the teacher told me she had a mover from a table because she was too busy socializing with the other kids and not doing her work. And I couldn't have been happier. Isn't that crazy? We couldn't have made it without a home within. When I took her to transitional kindergarten the first day, I remember her looking out on the playground and saying, "Nana, there's an awful lot of children here." And now, we can actually just drive up to the curb like other parents and let her go out on the playground by herself.
This story demonstrates the power of a stable, loving foster or adoptive family combined with therapy to help a child restore their ability to trust others and take joy in life over time. All too often, our current overburdened and fragmented healthcare system isn't able to provide this gift of continuity. In addition, the home within model is for therapists to support each other instead of facing this challenging work in isolation. With a community of stable, caring adults supporting each other, current and former foster youth can overcome trauma and break the cycle of abuse in their families. On behalf of our executive director, Reed Connell, who has spoken to you the last couple of weeks, and the whole A Home Within community, I want to thank FCCB for your interest and your generous support. Please help us to spread the word to therapists who might be able to volunteer with A Home Within and join the mutual journey of inspiration and hope that it supports. Loving God, we have known your presence in our lives and been sustained by your unconditional love and comfort. Please bless these gifts as we strive to bring your healing grace to a hurting world. Amen.
Friends, I just have a couple of announcements to make sure you know about. The first is to remind you, as always, that you have a couple of opportunities for community today. You can pop over to Chancel Communion immediately after the service. Bring whatever communion food you like and be in a little community of people who are being together over there. You can also pop right into the after party. Both of these things are on Zoom. Even if you've never been before, you are very welcome this week. Come be with some people, you know, come check in, come see how everybody else is doing. An opportunity to be with people in person today is the Teze service, which is happening this evening. I think it's at 7 p.m. At Michelle's house. So take a look in Realm for the address or message Michelle for that information. If you want to go and sing with others in person, I think that's a wonderful opportunity to be in community. Another online option is the Friday night discussion that's coming on Zoom that the Green Team is putting on. The movie is Other Side of the Hill. It's free to watch. The link is online, and Friday night's a great chance to show up. We're watching the movie in that Zoom. Watch the movie in advance and then come discuss it with others. Keep showing up to things as they are in this world and figure out how we can make a difference. And so let's take a moment together to receive the blessing that God is offering us. Friends, great is God's faithfulness. Great is God's faithfulness to us, as odd and twisted and complicated as we are, as hard as we make things. Great is God's faithfulness to us, and great is the work that God is doing in us, in these particular bodies, in this particular moment. So receive that blessing, the blessing of here and now. Use the tools you need. Grant grace to the body you're in. Receive from community the help and support you need, offered on behalf of God, whose love and faithfulness never ends. Amen. Thank you.
world.